last time I do a reduction, how to reduce the average Comets conjecture to the highs for CM points and Shimura curve. So and Shimura curve, this is very similar to modular curve. So in this case, we can do it in a similar way as a modular curve. So this is a formula, so something called the Charles-Silber formula and Shimura curve. And the first approved by Leach, Charles-Silber in the last century or whatever, depends on what you mean. So this new formula was approved in 2008 as a byproduct of a Gross-Zagier formula. Xinyi Yuan didn't publish it because we really don't know why this is the important formula. And so in today's lecture, I will first state put a statement of the theorem. It's already very complicated. Then I move back to modular curve. So just show you in the classical case, how can you prove it directly using the modular forms. Then I will move to Shimura curve, then give you an idea why this does not work. So I will talk about the Gross-Zagier formula. And so somehow, the interesting thing for the Shimura curve is that to prove Charles-Silber formula and to prove Gross-Zagier formula is the same difficulty. So there's nothing, say, one of them the simpler form or other, right? So actually, so the most important difficulty when you prove Gross-Zagier formula is a self-intersection, right? So when you have a self-intersection, if you don't have modular form, then you have to figure out what you're going to do, right? Okay, so I talk about statement. The statement of Charles-Silber formula. On Shimura curves. So the definition is very long. The reason is I needed to give a, so there's F is the total real field. Number field. And to define a Shimura curve, you need to have a set. So this is a set of places of F. And then you this is a finite, the finite set. And actually, the first condition you want to be with odd cardinality. Second thing, include all accumulative places. So this is the other set, including accumulative places. Then this data will give you a Shimura curve defined over F. So I will give a really formal definition, but it's not really important. So the idea is the following. So I can give just write one formal definition, is that it started with B is incoherent quaternion algebra over ideals A is AF. So incoherent with ramification set sigma. So this is sigma is odd. Incoherent means that this will never be a best change come from a quaternion algebra of F. So really mean that we can write this one is formally A plus AI plus AJ plus AK as usual. So the I square, J square, K square is in A cross, and IJ equals K equals negative JI, right? So that's a typical quaternion algebra. And so that's something quaternion algebra used when we formulate the Gross-Zagier formula. And this somehow is a very convenient thing. The reason is when we formulate the quaternion algebra, we consider it as the orthogonal Shimura variety. So this itself is viewed as a space. Okay, so and to give you so with the quaternion, if U, okay, the B infinity means you take all the infinity out, and maybe BF there, so just the finite place, finite part. Of B, and for any U inside BF cross the open compact, then this one give us some kinds of Shimura curve X of U. So this is it's a bit strange. The thing that this curve it's described by the following property, such as that if for any f inside C, in fact for any place, let me try to say where's the eraser, which has a uniformization. At OV inside of sigma. So usually, for example, the modular curve has uniformization at Archimedean place, right? But does not have uniformization at any other periodic place, right? So this sigma plays a role that this Shimura curve sometimes have the uniformization, the sigma, by either Poincaré upper plane. Or a dream field of a plane. So in some sense that, so either C minus R or CV, right? Minus what? It's FV, right? If this CV is FV, this algebra closure that take a completion, right? Of course, this is just set. You have to put some analytic structure in this set. More concretely, for example, if V is in sigma, then you have a B of V defined, B of V defined to be the quaternion algebra of F with the ramification set. Sigma take a V out, right? When they take a V out, it becomes the even set. Right. So you do have this then. Then, the BV tensor with A is the same. You can fix isomorphism. You can fix the isomorphism between this thing. For example, if V is infinity, well, let me try to write down one simple thing. Suppose it's infinity here. This F is isomorphic to BF. And then, this X at V as an analytic variety, so this is a Riemann surface, right? It's equal to B of V cross, you take the C, take this out, then you cross BF cross, take U out. So this is, if we really write down, it's a finite sum of a plane modulus some gamma I, right? So this is a finite. Just join union. The reason I do not write this thing is each of individual this one, so each of them of the kinetic component is a defined, not defined of F, but defined of abelian extension of F. Right. So, but the combined together will be defined of F. In fact, it's connected of F, but not geometrically connected. So this is pretty convenient to write all of them together, right? And we even know which one is. So in fact, it's not important, but just to give you an idea that so if you really want to study the XU, all the shift, right? So this actually is abelian extension.
So what's the action of BV on B on BF? Because BF, you take all the finite grades out.
What?
What's the action of BV on BF? You just use the
No, BV is a quaternion algebra whose ramification set is a sigma.
Yeah, but BF is only a finite part, right? So you only take the finite part on BV to act on BF.
So this one is equal to, I needed to define the action, this one over that. So this one will be equal to BV, right? So this one will act on that. So I fix isomorphism. That's the only reason I want to do that.
Because it seems that this definition of
Shimura
curl is different from your book. Okay.
My book? Oh, okay. No, I just give a description. So what is the uniformization that came in place is. Uh-huh. And the interesting thing that the way I'm writing down is V at a Archimedean place. Uh-huh. You also can do it when V is not a Archimedean. Right? Okay, so this is abelian extension of F. If you write it as FU, for example, the Galois group FU of F is, by class field theory, will be corresponding to this AF cross, you know. You take F, whatever, F cross, take infinity cross, take the norm of U, right? So this is a reduced norm. Maybe the reduced norm. So you have a quaternion B of V, right? You have a quaternion V to F cross. You have the reduced norm, right? So this actually is very explicit. So you really know which algebra is. So this is a very nice thing. And the important part is the following. So by the theory of Carreau-Greenfield, so that's actually this XU has canonic integral model. Canonical integral model is also easy to describe. The reason is when u is small, your curve have a genus greater than 2, so you will have integral model. So their theory say these minimum integral models actually is compatible when you make this system. Right? So this is actually so minimum model given by has a minimum model integral models. So this is actually equal to the minimal integral model when the genus of the kinetic component, genus of geometric kinetic component is greater than 2. So in some sense we can think about this give you idea that okay, so X is a integral models. So this gives you probably the simple way. You have two opposite ways to describe the question. So you can either talk about stack, when the minimal level, Well, you can take the limit OXU there. Right? I write X. This is the way I usually like. Or, I mean, or if U is really maximal, so, and then you get X of U as a stack. Right? Because when U is, when the genius of U is not small, the minimal smooth model is not the part of it. So that is, in that case, so integral model, let me say XU has a canonical integral model, XU when U is small. So in the, if U is not small, you just consider it as a stack. Right? Stack means that it has a covering by some groups. Okay, so this is, so anyway, this give you a well-defined differentials. So you, this give you L of U, it's inside the Picard group of X of U, tensor of Q. So this is basically the stacky differentials. Right, you can have a stack differentials, right? So, mean that you if you have X U, you covered by over the base covered by piece of a piece, then you move the level structure. When you have level structure, you can define the omega of U somewhere because the eta from there. But you cannot find eta cover directly from whole scheme, but you can put a piece by piece, right? So you can put two prime numbers, one prime to P, one prime to Q. Then in that term, you can put a P level structure and a Q level structure separately of the base scheme. Then you raise the level high enough, some power of the P, then you get an automorphism. There, the genus is greater than two, then you have a differentials. So you push it forward, divide by the degree you have, right? So you will get this thing. What?
Why you need two primes?
Oh, because you need the atom map.
The power of P and Q are large enough.
So you want to define there is a Hodge bond so that it's compatible with the pullback, right?
Okay, so you mean this morphism will be down only when the power of P and Q are both large?
No, to construct area U, you need to take a covering. Let me just give you one example. Even the upper plane, even X of one, right? How do you define a Hodge bound there? Right. This one is covered by say XP, XQ, right? So yeah, this is covered by, but this is over spec of Z, right? So you cover that by. This is, okay, that gives you some idea to do that. So this is a stack of this N, right? This stack is, so this is covered by spec of Z 1 over P, right? Cross union spec 1 over Q. So let's assume P and Q both are greater than 3 are co-prime to each other, right? Over here you have X of P, right? Here I have X of Q, right? So these two are really a scheme there. So this is the one you covered here, right? Right. So you take integral models, for example, you take integral models. Then you will have this X1 is covered by X of P, right? X of Q. Okay, so the common part is covered by X of PQ, right? You have the common part has a It's a PQ, so you don't worry that much. So you can define the bundle by, well, omega x of p, you push it forward, okay? So there's f there. The f equals the fp, fq, fp, you push it forward is a bundle. But you have to divide by degree, right? Degree of fp, right? Then you also can define fq, omega x of q, 1 divided by degree of fq. Right, you get two bundles downstairs, the q coefficient bundle. But these two bundles, you can also define this one, right? So you get three bundles, you know, fpq, xpq, divided by degree fpq. But this bundle only leaves over here. This bundle leaves over there. But the common part is isomorphic to this part. So this one isomorphic to this one. So this is over, well, over z joined 1 over pq, right? Z joined 1 over pq. Yeah, then you glue two shifts. Together, get a shift. And your x1, right? Well, I mean, the answer is actually is very simple. Answer is just this error of 1. It's just like the usual one. If you take the, if it's 1 is isomorphic to p1, I mean, think of this one is not, it's a p1, the plus, I don't know, plus the cusp, right? No. You have 1 minus half of I plus 1 minus 1 third, I forget. The probably one is this zeta 3, right? Right? It's just the two things added together. And if you take compactification, you need to add the cusp too. Infinity. So this is basically your Hodge bundle, right? But the Hodge bundle is constructed by this way. Okay, so let's just give you the idea for Shimura curve. You construct the integral models and also construct the Hodge bundle. Then, of course, you can define the Faltings height, right? So if E, so if P is any point, is x of U, then you can define the degree of P. Let me see. You can define the degree of the Hodge bundle, LU, right? At a PU, say PU here, right? Well, this will give you a point. But you have to, if you have a compatible family, say U1, goes x to u2, your Hodge bundle lu2, if a pi here, pullback is lu1, so you computed this supposed pu1 here, pu2 there, so you computed the height here and the computed height there is the same, right? There's no difference. Right. So this gives you. So this
the point is that by Greenfeld-Carayol, all these minimal integral models are compatible. In some sense, the natural map extends to integral minimal models, when the genus is bigger than 2.
Yes.
This is the point.
This is the point. No, I mean, the point that...
This is already a statement of Greenfeld-Carayol?
This is a statement in my paper. But essential ingredients are work of Carayol and Greenfeld. They never talk about that in this explicit. I mean, Carayol works on locally when P is not in sigma. Greenfeld works on P is in sigma. So Carayol's work basically is a generalization of work of Mazur, Katz, Deligne, Rappaport. This kind of work. It's a four-P split. Yeah, four-P non-split, that's a Greenfeld. Your Greenfeld final. Actually, the strict speaking, Zeronic Greenfeld. Cernik is, he just find purely by geometric method, and Trimfeld figure out how to define a modular problem.
But the point is that really the integral minimal model are compatible. So this is
right. This is the proof in my paper. In this average code mess, it took a while to prove that. Okay, so we can normalize this thing by so we define this thing. We can normalize if we normalize this thing by. So let's define the definition. So this H, Ru, Pu, I don't know why I'm in the take a half. I want to half probably means, oh yeah, this is a wet two forms, right? You take a half means that you only consider wet one form. F of Pu over Q of degree. Lupu. Okay, I write a GLS or less notation, put a head there. Oh yeah, I need to, okay, I need to put a metric there. So Ru has a metric at Archimedean place, put a V divide infinity. You see, Ru, when I have C there, is an essential extension, contains omega xu. No, I mean, it's essentially, when you use small, it's essential xu of c at v. So you just define a dz, this norm is twice y for z in upper plane. Okay, so that's the way you define. And later on, we'll figure the reason why I put a 2y there. So the theorem that, so this is what I call that is a Cholos-Eber formula. Yuan 2008 is that, so it has some assumptions. This assumption probably not that important, but the proof is that they assume that the sigma, the cardinality sigma is greater than 3, I guess. And there's no, and there, okay. Ah, I forget about that stuff. So I need to define the CM points first. I have not yet defined the CM points. So this is the height for arbitrary points. So the CM points is the following. So let E over F is a CM, quadratic extension. So you assume this also, assume that such that the E, when you take adels, can be embedded into B, okay? So in this case, this is a very interesting thing, because this X here I defined as all the projective limit of this thing has action by, this has action by of B F cross, right? Because I took all the limits there. So, but this thing, well, of course, they have action by E cross. So then, if we have this thing, then we can define this X of E cross. So this one is the CM point by E. So this is a pro scheme of dimension zero. Okay, and with the action, see, this thing is fixed by U cross, but priorly, this thing has action by even this part, right? So this actually has action by So with action, by E whatever tensor AF cross, because this one commutes with that. So this is a very interesting. I mean, this is the following way. It can be a really beautiful way to describe what is the reciprocity law. Reciprocity law is that this XE cross, of course, it is a scheme. It's a scheme defined F, right? Because I'm just a fixed point.
Is it scheme or pro-scheme?
Pro-scheme. Yeah, it's a pro-scheme defined of F.
Okay.
Yeah, pro-scheme is also a scheme.
It depends. It's not always.
In this way, scheme. Because every is finite. All morph is finite.
Ah, okay.
Right? So this is actually, so this has action by, if you, so X, E cross, take F bar, has action by Galois group, F bar of F, right? Also has action by, as I just said, E, let you write E hat cross. E hat cross, it's a simple way. Then write this one, you call it E hat cross. So you have two actions. These two actions commute to each other. And then, of course, then you have reciprocity law. The reason is this action is to make this one to be a homogeneous space. So this is actually isomorphic to, so there is a homogeneous space of E head cross modular, let me try to see, not a modular F cross. Modulus the F head cross. So F cross head is a what? Just a bar. Bar means that the closure of F cross in AF, F head cross. Okay, that's a complicated thing. The reason is that over Q, this thing is the same. Here is a different. So this thing it's somehow isomorphic to. So these two actions, action with this one, this is a pretty homogeneous space. So this induce on homomorphism of Galois F bar of F to this E of this thing. Okay, so in fact, this is factor zero Galois of E A B of F. So this is the reciprocity law you get, right? So this is the standard, yeah? Well, sorry, there is something goes wrong, because my E does not exist there. It's a fixed point by E, right? A bit confusing about what I'm doing here. What? Say it again.
You're already fixed by E.
Yeah, so this is fixed by E. What?
We don't see the reflex field of this.
Reflex field?
Of the CM point. So we should have an action of Galois. the reflex field of a CM point.
Okay, so maybe what I'm trying to say is, I probably get something wrong. So here has this one. Let me write it more precisely. We can go back to correct it. So this XE cross has two orbit under Galois. E bar of E, okay? So they just have two orbits there, right? So each orbit is a homogeneous space, principal homogeneous space, and Galois group of EAB of E. Okay? So that's what I'm trying to say. I'm a bit confusing what I'm writing here. So because this is not a standard class field theory, right? Because this is not abelian, right? So what I'm trying to say is the principal homogeneous space and the action is given by the reciprocity law, the standard reciprocity law. The Galois group EAB of E isomorphic to, well, E hat cross, right? Modular E cross, I usually take a bar, right? Right, because I want to make sure that, yeah, so that's what I really mean. But this one is equal to E cross F cross and the bar. It's the same. Okay, so now I write on the theorem. So this is the Yuan 2008, they basically say if let P be any point of X U cross, assume a bunch of things, right? But assume that, as I said, the cardinality greater than 3 and no place. Let me try to say the discriminant. So there no place of F is ramified, no finite place ramified in both B and E. Okay, so you sub this one. Just a basic assumption. If P is the same points, then there's a height of P is equal to negative 1/2 L prime of eta zero minus 1/4 log discriminant delta of E delta of F, then plus log delta of B. So this is a delta E delta F delta of B, an absolute discriminant. Okay. So we're not going to describe. So it's compared with the you see, this is the term depends on quaternion algebra. Every other term seems completely free there. Okay, so this is pretty much is a very simple formula there. And as Emmanuel just asked, the reciprocity law for this kind of Shimura curve is simple. It's very simple. The way we describe is very simple. So if you want from Hodge's theory point of view, there, so for example, if I take the B of V, right? So that if I started with this group, if you tensor real numbers, this isomorphic to M2 of real cross this Hamiltonian G minus 1, right? So the Hodge theory in this case is given by the simple way. If the C cross goes to this group, cross will be GL2 of real number cross H G minus 1. Is given by much a simple thing. If write z equals x plus yi, this goes to, okay, I want to want this thing to be have weight minus one, we'll get of x, y, negative y, x, right? That's the way you get. Then you have one there, you have minus one. So that's a Hodge theory. So this simple Hodge, so this has a weight negative one here. I mean, zero here. So this guarantee this is not a PL type, right? Because you have where zero somewhere. But there is only have one component here. So this makes reciprocity law very simple, right? Okay, so this is it's a very complicated thing. The reason I spend much time to talk about that is that if you just for some if our graduate students probably never see this Shimura curve, so I spend some time. So this is the simplest curve, simplest generalization of modular curve, where the reciprocity law is just as simple as possible. And the typical situation people work on is a PL type. PL type is the advantage you have abelian variety there. The disadvantage is that the reciprocity law usually is more complicated. Another thing is important, this Shimura curve does not parameterize anything, not even Hodge structure. The reason is this stupid F cross bar there. But if you replace group by smaller group, you say, I don't want to make such a big group, well, you have a bigger problem. So if I change the structure, let me see, how can I do? It's harder for me. If I can cut this group by, say, determinants is in Q, right? Then it parameterizes something. But I have to change the Hodge structure as well.
There is a construction by Dooley where you can change the center of.
Change the center, change something you can make so that it parameterizes some Hodge structure. But it's a parameterized Hodge structure in infinite level. Yeah, so you can put an infinite level so that there's no bar there. Then at a certain infinite level, then you have a Hodge structure. You can parameterize many things. So this is a very interesting phenomenon. So you get a Shimura curve does not parameterize anything in the finite level. You have moved to infinite level. Okay, so let's spend so much time here. So now I want to so the classical, I talk about classical Chalasepa formula. So I'm just to give you one idea. So at least something you can do. So it's F equals Q, sigma is just one place. So that's the case we're doing. So this one, the B of infinity is just the matrix. Right, so that's so we get, we are also the Q cross of a bar is a Q cross. Everything's very nice. So that's probably only the case it happened, right? So we will get, GL2 of Q bar. Q hat will be the standard decomposition GL2 Q. GL2 of Z hat. So in this way, you get x infinity. This is project limit. So this is the limit x of n of c. If you take all the project limit, you get this thing, GL2 of z join with upper or lower half plane. So this is a C minus R cross GL2 of Z hat. Okay? So this has many components, right? And so this is actually, this one, this is a moduli, so x infinity of C is a moduli of elliptic curves of A phi, so A over C is the elliptic curve, phi is just a trivialization of a tetra module. Right, it just trivializes your tetra module. But if I don't put a head here, if I no head here, that's upper plane. Right? So you say, if I don't have this thing, I just want to trivialize this, then I get a upper plane. But if I put a head there, then I get a GL2, G head. Right? So if I know, so there's, yeah, this C take R out, this is a moduli without this head there. Okay, so now I'm thinking about the proof, the original proof. So let's see. So now I'm trying the original proof. Of Charles Ebbeck. So an original, I mean, it's just the classical proof. I don't know how original it is. So the idea is the following. Idea is we can describe this shift very well. Idea is that this L x of 1, this is actually the bound of degree is 1 over half, 12. So this is the bound of, it's a fractional bound. So 12 is the power, of course, that's homomorphic to O1. If you think x of 1 as homomorphic to P1, for example. So at least you have one section, right? So then I can write this section precisely as the following. Okay, so this is the basic idea. So to take things more precise, let's do the following. So there's x of 1. It's a parametrized the modular stack of elliptic curves. So we have a universal family. I write A here, so A of x1, so this is the universal family. And first of all, there's a Cordero-Spencer map, omega A of x1, right? So this is, define this one to be, you have a section here, E. You pull back omega A of x1, right? Then you have omega A of x1. If it turns to 2, this is isomorphic to the Hodge bundle at infinity. All right, so this is a stacky one. And the interesting thing, you have to describe this one in a very precise way. You can normalize this isomorphism and the theta curve. At a theta curve, the theta curve is the GM, right? Modulo Q of Z. So you refer to A of Q, for example. So this is the curve over Z in the power series, Lorentz series of Q, right? A theta curve, you can describe this morphism precisely. So they write this morphism called the Cordera-Spencer map.
Should that be pushed forward by the universal map?
It's the same.
Well, you want it to be a sheaf on the set,
I want to be sheaf on x of 1.
Yes.
M is x1.
M is x1.
Say again, I don't understand.
There is M down. M is x1.
Oh, yeah, x of 1. Yeah, it just is the same thing.
The other one is by definition, it's the same thing as you.
It's the same because the invariant. This is a sheaf on here, right? I pull back, get a sheaf x of 1. By unit section. Now, if you have a scheme x of y, omega x of y is not a sheaf on y, it's a sheaf on x.
Yes, but you want a sheaf on y.
Yeah, so I have used a section to pull the back.
Oh, I see.
Right? It's basically the dual of Lie algebra.
Yes.
Right? Okay? Co-Lie algebra would have somebody call that. Right? But you're right. I mean, for elliptic curve, there's no difference. For narrow model, there is a difference. But narrow model has many kinetic components. So you have to determine, you take a push forward, your sheaf may have more sections than the section come from origin, right? So I just need to describe this sense. The Cordera-Spencer map, I want a Cordera-Spencer map of du over u square equals dq over q. Okay, so that's the normalization you're supposed to get. Right? So u is the coordinate of gm. Du of u is a invariant differential of aq. Then dq of q is the differential here. So if you so it's over a complex number, for example, if you take z of q map to complex number, right? For example, right, the q goes to become eta 2 pi I of tau, right? Tau's upper plane. If you do this thing, then you will get the aq will be c z plus z tau, right? Z tau plus z, right? If you use this coordinate, then the Cordera-Spencer map of 2 pi I dz square will be 2 pi I d tau. Okay, so that's an interesting thing. So this is why the many 2 pi I here, be really careful how many 2 pi I we're going to do. And now from this one you can calculate. So we know this one has a metric. This bundle has a metric using let's say omega A has a metric, Peterson metric, right? V Peterson metric, alpha equals 2 pi plus I here, I guess. alpha wedge alpha bar of A, right? Of A tau, A of C, right? Suppose this alpha is the section of an elliptic curve, just take the wedge product, right? So this side has a metric. Induce this side as a metric. So this metric, you can show that Ks of, I mean, so Kx, you can, Ks is isometric when the d tau has a norm defined by d tau equals twice of imaginary of tau. You can do the calculation, figure out this will be the true thing. Right, so this gives you a well-defined thing here. Okay, so I just want to give you a concrete calculation in a modular curve case. The next thing I want to do, okay, so I need to calculate the Faltings of height. The Faltings of height, it's a, so, okay, so the omega A of a 12, as I say, the degree 1 has a section, non-zero section. The section is given by the following way. Is essentially, is given by L equals to delta of Q du over U, the 12 to the power. Okay, so it's, you can write down this way. So that's usually, section whose expansion, whose restriction on tether curve is given by this way. So this is the Q product 1 minus Q to the n, n from 1 to infinity, du over u, the 12th power. The Cordier-Spencer map of L will be more interesting, right? According to this, what we're doing, it becomes Q 1 minus Q to the n, 24 there, dq over q to the 6th power. Right, so that's the one you want to do. Okay, so this is interesting. So we have a concrete section allows us to compute the Faltings of height. So if A, for example, if A is if A of O of L is on elliptic curve with semi-stable reduction, then of course this defined a morphism, right? This is defined a morphism spec of O of L to X of 1, right? So you can pull back this sheaf, right? So what you can pull back is the following thing. Well, so this L, so you pull back, say this is whatever, it's I here. So I pull back of L, the device of this thing is the usual, it's exactly the narrow differential, it's discriminant. Delta of A, so this is the discriminant divisor of A. So because there's a reason, you can compute the Faltings of height in a rather explicit way. So this gives you explicit computation. So the 12 L over Q Faltings of height of A will be the degree of omega A the 12th power, right? So that's just what we're just doing. And this will, if you write everything down, be the log of the discriminant error of Q discriminant of A, then minus summation O sigma error to C log error to sigma here. So it's just the computed heights. Well, I mean the error sigma is nothing, it's just a log of delta Q sigma and 4 pi imaginary of tau sigma would have a 6th power. Right. So you get a very explicit formula for Faltings of height. Right. So if your elliptic curve has CM, so if A has CM, then of course the good reduction of delta A is trivial. Right. So we don't have any sensor with the Faltings of height of A is just 1 minus. So H error can be written H. The behavioral class field. Then you have very much a simple formula. You have 12 there. H of Q summation of sigma H of C there log of delta Q to the sigma imaginary of tau sigma 4 would have a 6 of this thing. So, but this one is a modular function. Yeah, it's just a well-defined function up of plane, right? So the question will become, compute Faltings of height become, how can I compute this function? And you can do naively. The reason is this is infinite product, right? You can go there, just take a formal expansion, take a log, compute it in, then you immediately realize that this Eisenstein series. Right. So this is a kind of Eisenstein series. So in fact, so this is a modular function. By Kronecker limit formula. You can prove Kronecker limit formula pretty easily. Let me write down there. But Kronecker limit formula you will have, if we define a standard E tau of S to be summation Mn not equal 0, 0 of Y to the S M tau plus N to the 2S. Okay, so this is for S, a real part of S bigger than 1. It's convergent. It has a pole at S equals 1. It has a pole at S equals 1. So if you take the pole out, this is the formula. So E tau S minus pi of S minus 1. If you take expansion of that, you will get the formula. Imaginary, I guess that's exactly what you want. of to the sixth power plus O S minus one. Okay. So this gives you idea. So something you calculated is some is essentially Eisenstein series. Okay, so the proof of Chollet-Seibel formula is it becomes evaluate Eisenstein series on CM points. Right, so then it goes by the heck. So there, so you need to calculate summation of E tau of S. For example, if it tau is CM point of discriminant of delta, for example, right? You calculate this thing. And this is pretty easy to calculate. This is a heck thing. This is essentially the zeta function of the k of s. So if A has CM by k. Right. So this is just a heck's work. So it's just so then you find out you just bring everything inside, pretty much immediately you get there. So from this one you will get the Chollet-Seibel formula. So that's a classical proof. Well, the most lucky thing, you have a Dedekind eta function can be used to calculate Faltings of height. And there, once you get something so concrete, then another lucky thing, this modular function has something connection to Eisenstein series. For Eisenstein series, you can evaluate CM points. So there's many, a sequence of very good stuff happened here. Okay, so this method does not work. So this method doesn't work on any other Shimura curve. Even for Shimura curve of cube, the reason is there's no cusp. You don't have modular form, right? So that's the only thing you have. But the one interesting part thing is that if you for hyperelliptic curve, you do have a formula. But I do not see anybody spend time to study. For hyperelliptic curve, you can have a formula similar to the formula right in there. But I do not see people spend time to evaluate to study the modular function in the second variable. So you still can get some modular functions. And
that's only for genus 2, though, right?
For any. Really? Any hyperelliptic curve. Yeah. In fact, you see my paper, Gross-Zhang cycle, I have a Faltings of height right as a height of Gross-Zhang cycle plus some concrete terms. The Gross-Zhang cycle vanishes at for hyperelliptic curves. So that thing, yeah, so they have everything very concrete, but we do not know how to, I didn't see people spend the time to evaluate these modular functions.
What is the modular function? Then?
You read my paper. Okay. So I say there's a case to do that. But there's a good reason you're not supposed to know to know how to compute Faltings of height precisely. If you know it, morally means you know how to prove ABC conjecture. Because there's a local term, somehow So there, unless it's a hyperelliptic curve, they always have a secret bundle in the middle. This is the global invariance. There's no way to write a global invariance as sum of local invariance, right? So some global invariance, there's no way to write down the local invariance. If you know how to evaluate that, you will know how to compute the global invariance. The global invariance could be omega square, could be something else. So this is just to give you an idea. So don't try to show that every Faltings height can be computed. This is impossible. Okay, so now I talk about the, you want to take a break a little bit? Okay, maybe take a break for 5 minutes, you know. Okay, so there somebody asked me a question. Why any other, I mean, it only works for modular curve, not for Shimura curve. But you see, but somehow people work on a Shimura curve anyway, using something called a Jacques-Lagrange correspondence. The Jacques-Lagrange correspondence, strictly speaking, is about, you're talking about the relation between Haeckel algebras. So in other words, even there's no explicit construction module form, but they do have explicit construction of Haeckel algebra. So the second method I'm going to talk about, we don't use module form anymore. We will use Haeckel algebra to do the calculation. So this is somehow it's implicitly started in the, so let me write down the rough idea. The rough idea, another idea, the Gross-Zagier. Let me write it down. The Gross-Zagier formula. The Gross-Zagier formula is about calculating the isogenies between elliptic curves, right? Instead of so if you roughly speaking, what are you going to say? Say, roughly speaking, if you think about it, the Faltings height of an elliptic curve, as I said, that is the degree of this omega e, right? Right. But you can think about it if you, this is 1/2 of degree, well, is omega, so roughly speaking, x1, right, at e, right? So the bi-adjunct formula, so this is somehow you can think about it, so negative 1/2 is the p of e dot p of e, the adjunct formula at the junction. So you want to compute the self-intersection of a bundle there. So the Faltings height, you can view it as the computation of certain section arithmetic surface, self-intersection, right? We don't know how to compute it because, as I said, that because you need to have a module form to compute it. You need to have a form to push the section away, right? So this Dedekind error function is you use it to push it away. Now you don't know how to do that. Well, but there's a way. But there are ways to calculate, say, the p of e dot tn p of e if what I'm trying to say, this is a Haeckel, if the p of e has no self n isogeny, right? Because these two, tn over p of e, the summation of t of e prime, so e has an isogeny to e prime. Let me try to write it down. E, let me write it down. E mod C. C is a subgroup of E. The cardinality of C is N, right? You can calculate this thing, right? So at least you can calculate this thing there. That's the one thing you don't know how to compute, but you can compute their intersection of one elliptic curve with this thing because it's calculated isogeny, right? So the idea will be that maybe something we know how to compute is enough to recover something we don't know how to compute. The reason is the following. The reason is all of the Tn here, all right, for n, inside n, it's not a random cycles. They have relation between them, right? So this actually, there's a heck operators. And a form, a module form of weight 2. So this implies that T1 is a linear combination of TIs. Right, for many TMs. So this is the secret idea you want to use there. So I want to compute 7-7, I don't know how to compute it, but I can compute isogeny between two of them. I mean, if you give me two elliptic curves, I can calculate how many isogenies they can have. This is not hard, because this is just a modular problem, it's just a content by hand. Okay, so this is an interesting thing. Well, so the key, well, so this is done. But the calculation there's a PE T M PE is the main ingredient of the proof in the proof of Gross-Zagier formula. So that's the, in some sense, that the Gross-Zagier formula doing exactly this job, trying to compute their intersection between one elliptic curve and the Heck orbits an elliptic curve, right? And so secretly, Gross-Zagier formula must give another proof of Chalasseba formula. That actually is true. If you go back to read the Gross-Zagier as a paper, in the middle of somewhere they already computed. Right? But they also use they use the Dedekind iterator function to compute it. And then when we reread the paper, I found that that part is not necessary. So now my lecture is we are going to review the Gross-Zagier formula. Then I tell you why you do not need to compute the self-intersection. So let's write down the little bit of Gross-Zagier formula. Okay, so the fixed n be a positive integer. So x naught of n, well, this is just a moduli of elliptic curves. So this is just the moduli of isogeny of, say, a1 to a2 over phi. So this is elliptic curves. So the kernel of phi, you want to be cyclic. The j naught of n, the Jacobian of x naught of n. So the TM, the Heck operators of A1 to A2 is just order the image like that. So C is in is a subgroup of A1, subgroup. C joined with kernel of phi is trivial. Okay. The cardinality of C is M. So you write on A1 of C equals to phi A2 of C. Right. So it's just Heck operator defined by this way. So TM acts on x and Jacobian, J naught of N, and also okay, and so on the tangent bundle, right? So omega 1 J naught of N over Q. So that's exactly the cusp form, gamma naught of N. So this is the cusp form of way 2. So G naught, GMM, this is the geometric way, and you can access everything. The beautiful thing of this action is the following. The one really key observation that your Heck operators acts on Jacobian, its action is it's follow the action and the cusp forms. So for any 2-point x naught of n, you can formulate a generating functions to be the summation x take a 0, x take a 0, y tm, y take infinity. I just use the original formulation, 0, y minus infinity, take the narrow tetrahedral hard pairing, take a qm there, m from 1 to infinity, you can form these series. The key observation is that z x y is a cusp form. Oh, where to? Okay. So this is a very interesting thing, and the proof is not very hard. It just formally follow from this property. So it's not a difficult thing. So the question is, so the whole work. That's exactly what we want, right? We want to calculate the Heck operators of CM points and TM CM points, right? And the first term is something we want to put is a Faltings height. But first term, we do not know how to compute it. But the whole thing together, we know what's going on. So this is a cusp form of way 2. Okay, so that's great. So this will tell you that the coefficients has a lot of relation among them. Right, so there's many relations. Okay. So the major work of Gross-Zagier is to identify this form when both x and y are CM point. Okay, so there's no hope. For example, if I arbitrarily give you x and y, I don't believe there's any clue how to write down the cusp form. But x and y are CM points, this cusp form is actually a CM point. And they do this thing as a guidelines. So the motivated by BSD conjecture. Right? So otherwise there's no way you can check that. So essential result is the following. So we're not going to write them very precisely. So they found out, I will not write it down. So roughly speaking, so they found that Z, X, Y, the both of them CM, these absolutely linear combinations. Of two forms. So the linear combination projection, holomorphic projection of two form. One is Eisenstein series E tau S times theta of tau. So this is Eisenstein series, a derivative, for example, at a 1. So this is a E tau S is Eisenstein series. Weight equals 1. Theta is a theta series. Weight 1. Okay. So they found out this thing. They found out this thing because they believe BSD conjecture is true. Once they believe it's true, you can write the other side. Then, okay, the whole paper, 150 pages, but I don't know, just calculate term by term, that's true. Are completely equal. Okay, so they identify this thing. So let me write down, this part give a name called a phi of x or y. Right, so there is a they are concrete. So the z x and y equal phi x and y. So this is the main formula. So this is the explicit cast form. Where to? And this one I usually give called a name called analytical kernel. So this is called a geometric kernel. And this kernel, if your integration of phi against f usually give you the error function, derivative of error function. Okay. So the Gross-Zagier formula basically you construct geometric kernel by Nirenthal Hard pairing. It's a very cheap way to get a cast form. Then you're trying to say this cast form actually will connect to the error function because you believe BSD conjecture. But this side is very explicit. So you see, anyway, before you prove anything, you already know both sides are cast forms or where to. Right? So now trying to show they're equal. The key observation for us is that to prove two cast forms equal, you don't really need to compute everything. Right? You just compute the difference. It's sufficiently good. So that's exactly what the point I want to take. Anyway, I'm going to write down the Gross-Zagier formula. Let me write down before I do everything. So the consequence of calculation. Calculation is so-called the Gross-Zagier formula. So roughly speaking, so if of f is a morphism x naught of n to e, then if k if k is the same, k of q is the same, satisfies so-called Hingenden condition. This Hingenden condition is a name given by Birch. It's not given by Hingenden. Hingenden never used this condition. Actually, when Ye Tian and I work on a congruent number problem, we actually go back to original Hingenden's paper. We have to drop the Hingenden's condition. Hingenden condition basically means the following. Means that there is an idea such that OK of n is the sum of z mod nz. Okay, so of course from here you can find out what's going on. So then if you have this thing, then you can formula c mod n to c mod o of k, right? You get a point. Right. If you get a this way, you get a point. This will be inside x naught of n. Right. Okay. So Gross-Zagier formula basically says that this actually is defined over Hilbert class field H of K. So if you write it on, let's give a name, write a Y to be f of x, you take all the conjugates, sigma inside the Galois of hk of k. So this will be inside e of k. So you can compute the Nirentel height pair in there. The Gross-Zagier formula says that the derivative of e base change to k at 1 is essentially equal to the Nirentel height pair in y and y. I write a k here. Okay. So this is a formula almost conjectured by Birch. So according to the Birch's account that Gross-Zagier proved the formula before they made the conjecture. So they in the process of making conjecture, it's about to send the conjecture to Gross, but they already proved the formula. Okay, so this is the same here. Now I want to explain that if the Gross-Zagier not working hard enough, they can going to prove the Charles-Hilbert formula easily. So what is the idea to prove Charles-Hilbert formula? So one claim I want to say is the following. So one claim is that, well, I want to compute xtm of x. So x is the same point. I want to compute this thing. As I say, this one, you have two parts. One is you can write a tm of x equals some parts of x. Okay? Let's call the multiplicity rm of x plus some other tm, say 0 of x. Okay? You can write this way. So this one is disjoint with x. Right? You say a generic fiber. Generic fiber. Right? So that's something you want to do. So if you compute this thing, you bring this one inside here, you will get Rm x plus Tm 0 of x times x. So this one is computable. Right? And this one is not computable directly. But you need a differential form to compute it, because separate section, you need to push the section away. Right, so this needs a module forms, a differential forms, right? Differential forms to push, needed to push x away. I mean that you need in the move your section. 7 seconds moved away. This is a beautiful process of following. So you will get this one. So suppose you will get x tm of x qm. So this is a module form. Where 2 equal to summation x rm of qm plus xtm of 0 x qm. Right? So you get some formula like that. So this is a computable. Right? Okay. So assume I want to prove this thing equal to some phi, right? Assume this, suppose I prove this one equals a phi, this is some analytic kernel. Right? I mean, suppose this is known. And I want to compute this thing. The very interesting part is this one is a weighted one form. So the end of the story is that, well, something I do not know how to compute is actually is a weighted one form. But my equality is a where two form equal where two. Suppose I did this computation, this one, suppose this one equal to phi zero, for example, I compute something equal phi zero, then I know this one equal to some phi 1 plus phi 0. Suppose this is a weighted 1, right? Suppose this is a weighted 1, the difference will be, you know, the difference will be funny. Difference will be this is a weighted 1, this is a weighted 1. Before I do any calculation, the difference will be weighted 1, right? So there, okay, so let me try to write down here. Write down there the argument. I will go back to give you more precise information. The precise information will be that so precise information is the following. So this analytic kernel Tm of the QM, so this is the formula I want to prove because of phi. So before I prove everything, I know both sides are where two forms, right? And I know this one equals phi 1 plus phi 0. Phi 1 is a where one form. Phi 0 is nothing. I really don't know what phi 0 is. Phi 0 is some concrete power series. I also know this side equal to summation x times summation rm qm, right? I know this is a weighted one, plus the summation of xtm0 of xqm, right? Assume summation xtm0 xqm equals phi 0, then this will we'll conclude that these two are equal and these two are equal, right? The reason is, if this is true, what happened? If this is true, the difference of these two things is a weighted two form, a simultaneous weighted one form, right? So weighted two form cannot be equal to weighted one form unless both of them vanish, right? Understand? So that's the point. The point is that, so there, the point is that, so something, so this one, tzm xqm equal phi 0 implies the sigma x tm xqm minus phi equals, right, you take a difference of them, is x rm qm minus phi 1. So this side is a where 2. this side is a weighted one. Right, so that's a very nice thing happen. So the only thing, a weighted two form can equal a weighted one form, both them vanish. So both must vanish. So you get a Gross-Zagier formula and a Chernoff-Seibel formula simultaneously. But that's actually the proof for Shimura curve. That's the only way for Shimura curve to prove Gross-Zagier formula. You have to prove Chernoff-Seibel formula simultaneously. You cannot have separated one way by other way. So now I go back to say why this one is a weighted one form, right? This is not difficult to calculate. Let's do the calculation. The calculation is rather easy.
So you have this fact that they both vanish. What do you conclude from that?
Oh, this vanish means it's a Gross-Zagier formula. Because I proved this one equal this one. This vanish, it means Chernoff-Seibel formula, because I know how to compute self-intersection of X. Right, so this give you Gross-Zagier, this give you Chernoff-Seibel.
So you're saying you know in advance what should be phi?
Right.
Yeah. You know in advance what should be the formula for.
Yeah, because this one I know how to calculate. So something I do not calculate, I don't know how to calculate, I know it's a weighted one form. So something I do not know how to calculate, I know what the shape of this thing is, right?
So you get rid of 50 pages of Gross-Zagier?
Something like that. So anything he used, dedicated error function can be erased. They do not really need it for that part. But anyway, when you do Shimura curve, then you must do this way. So I mean, it's not because we found this. When we work on Shimura curve, this is the first thing we have to think about it, self-intersection, right? So self-intersection is always the most difficult thing to handle, right? When Brylinsky even worked on highways, he could not even define the self-intersection. So this is why RKL theory is very important for this Gross-Zagier type thing. So I need to calculate, I will finish my lecture by calculating the RM, because this is an interesting thing. It's completely elementary. So you want to compute the RM is a multiplicity of X in TM of X, right? So this is what? It's called a cardinality of isogeny between phi e equals to e, right? Suppose x represents e. The e, say, is a c module O of k, right? That's, everything is very concrete. So the kernel of phi is isomorphic to, cardinality equals m. Degree of phi equals m, right? It's a very easy thing. So, okay, the phi is equal to e, so there's nothing. It's just the phi inside O of k, because n of e is k, right? So there's a norm of phi is m, right? So that's exactly, well, that's the weighted one forms. This is just, it's just a part of, so this is Rm. It's just a part of elements in O of K whose norm is M, right? So this is, so we know there's a summation Q to the norm of X inside O of K plus, maybe plus something, I don't know, W over 2, whatever. So this is a weighted one, it's a theta series. Or weighted one. So this is trivially, it's true. So there. So something we do not know how to calculate is given a weighted one form inside. So, but our calculation about a weighted two forms. Right. Yes. Okay, so I didn't talk about it. The Xinyi Yuan proof. The proof, of course, for Shimura curve now is very clear. You put in the Shimura curve, you compute this thing. It's a general case. Yeah, so this method for Shimura curve follows. No. Yeah, for Shimura curve. So this method, yeah, this method. Yeah, it works. For Shimura curve. So because we do not need differential form to calculate self-intersection section. So now you ask me, what's the secret that we use here? The secret we use is the following. Secret we use that heckhold, we do not have their section, obvious section for differential forms, but we can move Heck operators. We secretly use that Tn, the T1 can be write down the summation of Tmi, basically what we use. We move a cycle by this thing, right, alpha I. So somehow you are working on say xtm xx, you can write down sigma xtm ix somehow. So this side you know how to use it. So secretly we move Heck operators instead of doing differential forms. And then this second philosophy also agree with the other group's proof, the proof by Andriata, Benghaud, and Goren and Matapusi Para. What do they do? They make it even more explicit. They're using Boucher's method. The Boucher's method is construction sections of differential forms, right? Construct section differential forms with precise zeros and poles, right? But one disadvantage of the method is that only it can work for Shimura variety of orthogonal type over Q. So you cannot really use that method to do anything more than that. But this method is using modularity of Heck operators, right? But that's like a much more common thing happened there, you know. And yeah, and recently I trying to do same story for U21. And so maybe in the November I can, if I finish successfully, I can talk about the proof, maybe the full coolness, and or some hint modular, some rational numbers. Looks like it's doable. Okay, so I should stop here.
Case, somehow you have to know in advance what is the phi, and
oh yeah, yeah.
The yoga to know what you should find.
Okay, so that's a very interesting thing. You ask the right question. So when Gross-Zagier did their proof that they're completely motivated by BSD. When we do it, we're not modified BSD. We modify by Vaspuget formula. So the Vaspuget formula give us exactly the same thing. So it's in the 1982, right? Maybe 86. So there's a independently there's a Gross-Zagier work and the Vaspuget work. Vaspuget work is completely general for arbitrary Shimura. Arbitrary quaternion algebra, whatever. And for a long time, we do not know there's a relation. So in fact, there's a Gross even wrote their own formula. I guess it's a similar time. Completely trying to figure out what the Gross-Zagier is. And probably after 10 years, I don't know how many years. At least probably after 10 years, we know the Gross formula is a subset of the Vaspuget formula. So, the work on the Shimura curve in our book is just to use this formulation. Right, so this is over x naught of n. So then we get the diagram. So this is a local intersection. Then there's a fiber product will be the Gross-Zagier of a Shimura curve. Right. So this is done in 2013. It's a very long late. Right. Yeah. So it's exactly formulation there.
So what Piaget is in the compact case, no?
What Piaget, no assumption. Yes.
No assumption.
No assumption and anything. But Piaget is not working on any Shimura curve. He's working on quaternion algebra, the modular form of quaternion algebra. So there is a recipe. So the Piaget's way is the following. It started with any E of F, any quadratic extension of number fields. It starts with any representation pi for GL2 of F, and a chi GL1 of E. You start two representations, right? And you make only such that pi times chi is a kind of self-dual. That's the only condition you assume. Because you're going to work on the center of your error function. Once you have this thing, you get, this will give you a sigma. Sigma is a number of places, the final set of places in the beginning of my lecture. In Vaz-Piaget's case, the sigma is always even. Right? Because he started with a quaternion of a field. In my case, sigma is always odd. So you can say the formula we proved is called arithmetic Vaz-Piaget formula, for example. Yeah. So that's the So this is the same thing. The other side completely. Well, no. So this is not really modified by BSD. Yeah. For example, actually this point of view is important because next class lecture, I will talk about Yuan and Zhang's work, Shou-Wu Yuan and Wei Zhang's work. They figured out how to do arbitrary derivative, right? But that's nothing. BSD doesn't cover arbitrary derivative. BSD is supposed to cover the leading term, right? So Gross-Zagier formula is a one very special formula in a very big spectrum there. And there is the same thing. You need a calculator instead of computing the isogeny between elliptic curve. You need to computing the isogeny between Stokers. And again, we don't know how to compute the self intersection with Stoker. So you need a high corporate to move them away. Yeah, so you ask a really nice question. So the new one is not modified by BSD at all, you know.